Telecast is presented by the authority of Cleveland State University. It is intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of Cleveland State or WOIO Television is strictly prohibited. Golden Griffins in all sorts of trouble here at Woodling Gymnasium this evening.
And you know, for the benefit of those fans who may be watching us nationally on the Sport Cable Network, you notice one thing, that no matter how big a lead the Cleveland State Vikings have, they never take the press off. Sometimes they've been criticized for it because against lesser teams like Clarion State, they scored 135 points here, and one of the local columnists came out criticizing them because they never took the press off. But that is the way Kevin Mackey plays. 10 men at least are going to see action. 11 have seen action tonight, and they're always going to be pressing. That's why you play so many guys.
Marvin Bailey with 18, and he is the top point producer for the Golden Griffins of Canisius here this evening.
And only came into the game averaging 6.2.
Ramsey inside with a tough shot. Rebound kicked out to Chris Heinold. Number 50 takes it inside. Running one-hander, no good. And Vianchik. If Pat is the guilty party, I unofficially have him for five on the night, but let's wait.
Well, you're right. Well, I thought that Eddie Bryant had gotten him first of all, but there it is, and definitely a slap on the wrist by Pat Vianchik, who fouls out with 7 points on the night, all seven coming in the second half.
Pat will never be cheated when he comes out to play. He gives you 115% each and every basketball game. Boy, it's about time for us to start thinking about that Miller Viking of the Game Award. I don't know, Mouse McFadden started so quickly, and he really got the Vikings off and running with 13 first-half points. He has 23 on the night. But, boy, a case could be made for Clint Ramsey as well, who has 20.
I would be leaning toward Mouse McFadden, though, because of the 8 steals. He has certainly created a lot of offense. He hasn't scored the points, but he's always given them off to somebody else.
Now we'll leave everybody in suspense, and we'll wait until after the game to decide. McFadden with a bit of a force that time, though. Now it's 3-on-1. Heinold with a tough pass that Bailey can't hang on to, but the Mouse back quickly on defense slapped it out of bounds.
And that's one of the reasons that I would be leaning towards McFadden.
There's a block by Kenny Robertson. Oh, he closes like a professional defensive back, doesn't he?
The little man is amazing.
Yeah, pump fake by Mosley that time, who didn't want to shoot it back at Robertson. Kenny Robertson comes down with a basketball. You know, he has the innate ability, when the ball goes up in the air, to go and get it, regardless of who he's jumping against. And that's something you just can't teach, Alan Davis. That's just intuition and the ability to get up there faster than everybody else.
He also has the speed to go along with that leaping ability. And I know that in high school, he did go down to the state as a track man. He ran a 49-second 400 meter. And I know that the track coach here at Cleveland State, Dave Berger, has got to be drooling, wondering, what are you going to do after basketball season's over, son?
I think he has the ability to play two sports. No question about that. Made the first, missed the second. And we're under 2 minutes to go now. Heinold with a bank shot. And the basket is no good. Chris pleading his case, but it's fallen on deaf ears.
If you think he's pleading his case, Nick McCartzik, just standing in front of us, is pleading it even more strongly.
And, of course, the next broadcast, as far as Cleveland State basketball on 19 is concerned, will be coming your way on January 12th, 1987 at 8 p.m. And the Vikings will take on the Rattlers of Florida A&M right here at Woodling Gymnasium. Have to bring the snake bite kit.
They have a busy week that week. They also play against Bowling Green that following Thursday, and then open up MQA conference play.
78-57. This one's pretty much out of the wood. as they say. Under 2 minutes to play. Nice move inside. Hersey Strong turnaround. Uh-oh, jam try by Bradley. No good, and he grabbed the rim. Technical foul for grasping as well.
Now, wait a minute.
Murph Shapiro making the call.
Well, I'll tell you, if we have that on replay, I'd like to see that again, because I don't really think that Warren Bradley did anything out of the ordinary. All right, let's take a look at it again. Now watch. I think he was just grabbing the rim to protect himself.
Well, the rule states that if you're doing that, it's not a technical foul. See it one more time. Yep. Tough one to call.
It's a tough one to call.
I think maybe the officials had the correct call there.
I think the best call in a situation like that is no call at all, because the game is out of hand. I don't think that one more point is going to make any difference as far as Canisius is concerned.
Warren Bradley high for the rebound, and he was fouled on the way back down by Marvin Bailey. Well, what do you think? Mouse McFadden tonight? Miller Viking of the game?
Well, we've already given it to Clint Ramsey once, so I think that it's only fair that we spread it around a little bit.
Okay. Good idea. Warren Bradley with a free throw that rattles around and then finally drops through. Well, I have a feeling that if you'd have told Kevin Mackey before the season started, especially with what happened to Eric Mudd, that he was going to be 8-2 when he left 1986, he'd have kind of looked at you with that smile and said, geez, I'd love to be in that position.
I couldn't agree with you more.
I think he's tickled to death at this point. And both losses were very close losses. Uh-oh, there's a miscue. And on the way to the basket, it's a hack fest. Hersey Strong and also Miles McFadden. With about a half each of Marvin Bailey. Regardless of who gets the personal foul, Bailey is going to be hurting in the morning.
A little bit too much exuberance here on the part of Hersey Strong. He went up for the ball, but came on down with the arm over the arm of Marvin Bailey as Warren Bradley takes a seat.
Bailey with an excellent performance this evening as that one rims in and out. Marvin Bailey with 18 points on the night.
You know, you talk about that 8-2 record for Cleveland State, and you go back to that Akron game. You and I saw that one in person, and you think, boy, if only.
Anthony Gay checks in to the Cleveland State lineup and doesn't waste any time in launching a two-pointer off the glass. Gay with his first basket of the night, and it's 82-59.
You know, here's a case of a guy who is very talented, but just is in that unfortunate situation of being at a school with four very good guards who have experience over him. And right now it's very difficult to find Anthony Gay some playing time. And I know it's got to be very frustrating for him, because his duty is going to be very limited this year.
Jamel Mosley with a nice move to the foul line, got the jumper off. The shot went awry, and there's a whistle and a foul down low. Chris Einold, I think, got called for trying to grab himself a little extra position. What are you getting back to that point about Akron when you talked about the fact that we were there?
If they had made one more free throw in regulation, you know, they only shot 52% from the free throw line, 13 of 25. One more or two more free throws in regulation, that game would have never gone into overtime. And their record very easily right now could have been 9-1.
And when you consider the fact that Akron is what, 8-1, and a team that went to the tournament last year, would have been great to have a victory over them as far as down the road is concerned when that NCAA tournament rolls around.
And that's nothing to take away from the Zips and Bob Huggins, because they have a very good program over there, and it's kind of a shame when the two teams play that a team has to lose.
Yeah, that was a tremendous basketball game.
Probably one of the best collegiate basketball games I have seen personally.
This telecast is presented by the authority of Cleveland State University. It is intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of Cleveland State or WOIO Television is strictly prohibited. That was a replay there of that. Bailey with 21.
Let's also point out the fact that we also have in the lineup Mike Raby, a walk-on from St. Ignatius. He is number 22 for the Cleveland State Vikings. These guys don't get that much playing time, and you always like to recognize them when they do get in. As we wind down the clock to no time remaining, and that is it.
A couple of last-second efforts, both missing the mark. Kevin Mackey congratulating the Canisius staff and their players. And getting back to that one point, I think Kevin is very excited about the fact that his ball club is 8-2.
That's right, 8-2, and they score 82 points tonight to 61 for Canisius. 61, the same amount of points that Canisius scored in the first game. But this time, of course, the Vikings scored more than the 66 they scored the first time.
And Al and I will be back to wrap up victory number 8 on the season for the Cleveland State Vikings. The final score, 82-61, and you're watching the victorious Cleveland State basketball Vikings on 19. Okay, no Vidius. Now, what are we doing here with this? What are we doing with this Viking of Miller Viking of the Ward or game or whatever that is? Okay.
Right.
Now, I need to read this little thing as far as he's concerned too, you know. Okay, I'll read it. Okay. 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 So just count me down, Jimmy, when you want me to go here.
Okay.
Oh, good. We're going to throw those up. Oh, good. Okay. Cleveland State fans are milling out of Woodling Gym, and once again, Alan Davis, geez, what's that make Kevin now here? 36-2 overall in 4 years with a victory, 82-61 over Canisius, and it's victory number 8 on the season as far as the Vikings are concerned, and one gentleman who played a pivotal role in tonight's victory was Ken McFadden.
That is correct. He is our Miller Viking of the game, and you're going to see his stats in just a moment. 23 points for the Mouse. Had 22 the first time these two teams met. 2 rebounds, 8 steals, and I think that's the key statistic of the evening.
And the Mouse will receive a plaque, and also a donation will be made to the CSU Development Fund in the Mouse's name. And, of course, the good folks at the Miller Brewing Company supplying that. The Viking of the game, Ken McFadden. That was a tough decision, basically, too, because Clinton Ramsey had a heck of a game this evening.
20 points, and he really came on strong in the second half. But as we said earlier, we should spread it around a little bit. Clinton Ramsey did get the Miller Viking of the game the first time we telecast the game.
That's right, and there are still plenty more games to come, and Al and I will be back to wrap things up here from Woodling Gymnasium right after this message. You're watching Cleveland State Basketball on 19. What's next, Jimbo?
Huh?
Hello, Sports Central. What's next here? What am I pitching this thing to? Are we, as I leave tonight, do we have a show coming up here, or what's the deal? Do I not promo any of this stuff? So I just say goodnight then, right? Okay. Well, give me these. Am I going to see a graphic of that? Okay, good. Okay. Happy New Year. And Merry Christmas and Happy Hanukkah.
Oh my God, settle for me.
Now, Jim, you won't show Alan and I anymore, right?
Not knowing that Kenny McFadden would be there. I'm sure he didn't see him. He must have eyes in the back of his head if he did.
Biggest lead of the night for the Vikings at 7 points, 25-18. 7 minutes remaining. Taggart with a move inside, running left-hander, no good, and the Vikings are on the move again. Bryant left wing, pump fake, nowhere to go, throws it up, shot no good, but an offensive foul is called.
And that was a good call. Eddie leaned in thinking that he might get the personal call on his opponent.
And we've got a timeout on the floor. So with 6 minutes and 54 seconds left here in the opening half, our score is Cleveland State 25, Canisius 18. You're watching Cleveland State basketball on 19. Why don't we try and get to this? Why don't we try and get to this? There's a graphic for this?
Hey, who do you have for number 45? Mike Brown, okay.
.54 remaining in the opening stanza, and Cleveland State now leads by 7, but it hasn't been easy, 25-18. Percy Strong back in the lineup, as is Ray Salters. Salters with a steal, and a push, though, called about midcourt on number 50, Chris Heinold, who looks a little bit frustrated at this point, Alan Davis.
Yes, he certainly does. He committed 4 personals against the Vikings the last time. I think he was frustrated because he lost the ball and he wanted to go after it and instead went after Ray Salters.
Unfortunately, Ray was between the ball and Chris. That's right. That's where the problem therein lied.
You know, the Vikings, actually I should say the Golden Griffins, had 3 players foul out of that first game. So it was a physical battle.
Middle back, you said we were glad we got out of there with their lives. 20 left on the shot clock.
Both teams making some very interesting passes as Sean Hood loses the ball there.
Sean bounced it off his foot, but a steal back the other way by Warren Bradley. Nice hustle
by
the big man.
Great defensive work.
Salters inside in traffic. Shot is good. Whistle and a foul. Salters now with 5 on the night, and he could increase the Vikings' lead to 10.
Boy, Ray Salters playing the game of his life so far in the early going. Watch this. He fakes the shot, takes the dribble, and he got slapped by Minnick. I don't know if you saw it on the way up.
Grady Minnick with his first personal foul. Salters hits the free throw. Ray now with a half dozen on the night. Kenny Robertson checks back in, and the Mouse McFadden will sit down. 28-18, CSU's biggest lead of the evening.
And the Vikings in their 55 zone press, 1-2-1-1.
Probably their best zone press. I imagine Canisius will get tired of looking at it before the night's over. Under 6 minutes to play here in the opening half. Steal and a foul from behind. And each and every time down the floor, the overall quickness of Cleveland State beginning to play more and more of a factor in this one.
Marvin Bailey's going to get called for this one. Watch Hood. He's so small, and you wonder how a 5'7" guy, what business he has out there on a court with a bunch of 6'5" guys. But look at this. This is sometimes where it pays to be small, because you can sneak right up under, make no contact, but the other guy makes contact with you.
Great anticipation, and it'll be a very good defensive player. You have to anticipate. Saunders wanted to pull the trigger, but decided the better that time.
I was going to say, Sean Hood and Eddie Bryant, two of the first guys that Mackey recruited his first year here, and everybody sort of raised eyebrows when they heard about it.
13 left on the shot clock. Now it's under 10. Hersey pulls up, takes the jumper, no good. Robertson went high for the rebound, but couldn't come down with a basketball.
I'll tell you what, before this guy's career is over at Cleveland State, you're going to see this young man do some amazing things.
Well, both elbows were above the rim that time, and Robertson just couldn't snare the basketball. Fans booing Canisius because they didn't take the layup opportunity. But obviously, the Golden Griffs are going to slow this one down. If they don't, and they let this become a horse race, it could be over in a hurry.
And Ray Salters gets called for a second personal, and that will send Grady Minnick to the line. And Elgin Womack back into the ball game, replacing Warren Bradley.
Elgin, what do you think at this point? Probably about 85-90%, Alan?
If that much. But I'm sure that he's being pressed into service a little quicker than Kevin Mackey would like him to, but it's out of sheer necessity.
Minnick with his first point on the night. Grady Minnick, 6'2", 205-pound sophomore guard. With a pair of free shots.
Michael Ray Jackson now into the ballgame for the Golden Griffins. I like that name, Michael Ray Jackson.
Sporting that Carl Lewis hairstyle. Yeah, is it Michael Jackson or Michael Ray Richardson?
Right.
It's a toss-up. 28-20, Vikings by 8. 4.5 left here in the first half. Three-point shot, no good. Saunders keeps it alive. Uh-oh, can't make the bunny down low, and Heinold comes off with a rebound. Taggart on the move, kicks it backwards, and Jackson can't run it down. And it was a three-on-one break that ended up in a turnover, and that'll give coaches gray hairs.
That's one time when selfishness is probably the better thing to do. He should have gone for the shot himself, as you see Nick McCarchick probably telling him the same thing there. He really didn't see anybody back there, but he should have gone for it himself. Try to be unselfish, passed off, and instead it resulted in a turnover.
Clinton Ramsey reinserted into Cleveland State's lineup. Vikings have been very patient on offense, half court wise. Just as I say that, Hersey Strong takes a 20-footer that doesn't hit anything. Another turnover, another unforced error. Nick McCarchuk right now is going to wear out a brand new pair of shoes if his team continues the turnovers, as we've got a timeout now on the floor with 3 minutes 43 seconds left in the opening half. The score, Cleveland State 28, Canisius 20, and you're watching Cleveland State basketball on 19. Well, what do you think? Okay. What do we got, Jimmy? Do you want me to try and pop this this Minnesota meets Tennessee in the Liberty Bowl? Okay. Vikings led by as many as 10. The lead now has been shaved to 8. Had one nice spurt, but Allen Davis, the 8-point lead has been hard fought here this evening.
Well, they had leads in Buffalo, too, when they played Canisius the first time, but lost them. Actually, at halftime of that game, they were trailing by 1 point, 30-29. And you can see as Elgin Womack gets hacked as he goes up for the shot.
Elgin being bumped in the paint that time, sort of rolled his eyes after the foul was called. And when you do come off any kind of surgery, whether it's ankle or knee, you have a tendency to be a little bit tentative, and here you'll see it. Nice to get the ball inside to the big guy and make him work for it a little bit, but boy, when you have to test it under fire the first couple of times out, it's a little scary.
Well, Elgin has a nice shot, a nice little short jump hook, and he's very quick with his release, and he will draw those fouls. Now the question is whether he can convert, and you see there the effects of the long layoff. He is he missed his first free throw, of course, that when it comes to Cleveland State players. That could be said for just about any one of them.
Yeah, but he made amends there. 1 for 2 on the brand new season. Elgin will sit down, big double zero. Warren Bradley checks in. And Eddie Bryant also back in the Cleveland State lineup. Sean Hood getting a rest.
Boy, but it's good to see Elgin playing. He can make such a valuable contribution to the team this year, and it's a chance that he's waited for all 4 years that he has been here at Cleveland State. It's been a very frustrating career for him.
Well, with injuries, Kevin Mackey right now at a shortage as far as front court players are concerned, so the sooner Elgin comes back and gets involved, the better off the Vikings will be. 29-20, it's a 9-point spread. Near steal out front. Nice penetration move that time by Grady Minnick, who ran over a couple of people in the process as Greg Lockhart gets up off the green paint inside. And it's tough when you have to try and establish position defensively when one of those guards is taken off at the foul line.
Well, here's a situation where Minnick got past Clinton Ramsey with that quick move, and Eddie Bryant had no choice but to foul him to stop what was definitely going to be a 2-point basket. Actually, gee, I thought McFadden got it before Bryant did.
You're watching Cleveland State basketball on WOIO 19, Shaker Heights, Cleveland. Minnick misses the free throw, and the Mouse comes off for the basketball. Vikings are averaging better than 86 points a game this season. They're well under that mark at this stage. Offensive foul called on the spin move. Warren Bradley with a shoulder as Marvin Bailey took the plunge.
And Kevin Mackey did not like that call at all. I don't know if he didn't like the call or he didn't like the fact that Warren made that move. Of course, Coach Mackey is not expecting a lot of scoring out of Warren. He's told him, just get me the rebounds and be aggressive on those boards. And so far he's done that. He averaged 7.9 rebounds per game so far this season.
Conference play hasn't started yet, but according to those current stats, Warren is the leading rebounder in the MQ8 conference. Now Lockhart down low trying to establish position, pushed Marvin Bailey right out of the paint and get called for the personal foul as Kevin Mackey with palms up and extended is asking why in the world the foul was called.
We're getting a couple players in foul trouble early, and Greg Lockhart now has two, but we've got Eddie Bryant and Pat Bianchik, who hasn't seen very much action, both on the bench with three.
Numerous fouls called when these two teams battled in Buffalo earlier in December. Both teams very physical, both teams press from one end of the floor to the other, and anytime you get that combination, the officials are going to have to blow the whistle. Warren Bradley with the loose carom. The Vikings still lead by 9, though. It's not a comfortable lead, but 9 is better than none.
You know, coming into the game, Warren had 71 rebounds to lead the team, and I checked last year's stats, and at this point, the leading rebounder last year was Bob Crawford, and he only had 67. So Warren is ahead of the pace.
Percy inside in traffic, couldn't buy the basket. And Mike Brown comes off with a rebound. Brown at 6'9", a transfer.
The leading shot blocker in the history of the state of Delaware in high school. That's what his high school coach said about
it. We better mark that down, don't you think?
That's right. But here's one of our leading feeds in the history of Cleveland State.
Yeah, leading steel man Sean Hood with an easy basket. Hood with his first hoop of the night. And it's 31-20. Pressure is on. 1:17 left, and the clock is rolling here in the opening half of play. Michael Ray Jackson with a nice dish off. Bailey took it to the basket, got fouled by Sean Hood. And this will be tricky because Sean Hood and Warren Bradley both put their hands up to specify that they fouled.
Somebody had to stop him because otherwise it would have been an easy basket.
Bailey will head to the free throw line with 9 points on the night. Well, let's see. I think both players ended up with it.
He had the baseline wide open. Well, we couldn't see from that angle, but maybe it's good that they called it on Sean as opposed to Warren because, well, he can't even afford to lose Sean either because we've got Eddie Bryant with three fouls.
Here's another look. Somebody forgot to play some defense down low. I think maybe both players got a piece of him.
Well, fortunately, Marvin Bailey only converted one of those free throws.
Vikings with a win tonight could tie their start.
I disagree with that call. Sean had the ball knocked out of his hands before he picked it up again, but obviously they didn't see it.
Well, with that many bodies down low converging, sometimes you do miss that. But if that's the way it looked, the ball was slapped away. But
the thing that makes the call somewhat questionable is as we get an offensive foul from the other end. The thing that makes that call questionable is the position of the official when he called it.
Are you in favor of using three officials, Alan Davis, or two?
I think for this type of basketball, you definitely have to. With no disrespect to them, but they are grown men officiating a game that is played by younger men who are like racehorses.
Shot clock is now off as Sean Hood eyes the game clock at 20 seconds, and Sean is going to stand right at... Ramsey on the wing. The mouse has it back. Penetrates, takes it inside. Oh, my!
What a move!
Loop-de-loop by McFadden, who now has 13, and Canisius will run out of time here and will not even get the ball to half court. Stellar move by the sophomore guard out of New York City. That brought the fans to their feet here at Woodland Gymnasium. They have been quiet from time to time, but I have a feeling they'll be more excited perhaps in the second half. Our halftime score here at Woodland Gymnasium, Cleveland State 33, Canisius 21. You're watching Cleveland State basketball on 19. Okay. Hey, Jimmy, what's this thing called now? The Big Mac Report?
Or the McDonald's Kevin Mackey? Halftime Big Mackey Report.
Okay. Well, I just wanted to make sure. Okay. Okay, right. Okay, this halftime thing is not, we're not on camera then? Okay. Okay. Dee, 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 dee.
hit the backboard anyway.
I'm not so sure that
was a
little
bit of Hollywood there,
foul,
and I think the official fell for it.
That's what you have to work on.
Yeah, I have to say that they have done an admirable job today. They haven't fallen for some of the acting that's gone on, and of course that's part of college basketball today. The guys are going to do it, see if they can get away with it. That time, I think Clinton did a little bit. Other times he doesn't.
And don't forget, there's more sports action coming your way this weekend on 19. Tomorrow night, live at 8 p.m., Minnesota meets Tennessee in the Liberty Bowl. And then on Wednesday, the college football action continues at 8 o'clock with the All-American Bowl. College Bowl action Monday and Wednesday at 8 o'clock on 19. And of course, we're sports and we're yours.
Followed by the Cereal Bowl and...
And
every other bowl in sight.
How about the Tidy Bowl?
That's right.
Have they played that yet?
I don't think so. Oh. Hey, by the way, while we have the chance, let us congratulate the CSU women for their first victory of the season last night, 66-59 over Rhode Island.
The Antsic shot partially blocked, and Heinold comes down with the loose ball. Fans wanted a foul, but no call. Nick Makarchek calling out the play. The fans want some fast-paced action. Golden Griffins at this point trying to slow it down. Heinold in the paint, turnaround jumper, banks at home, shot is good, whistle and a foul, and Warren Bradley, I have a feeling, will pick up the personal.
And you know, our sports information director here at Cleveland State, Merle Levin, just came in and gave me an amazing stat as we watch this basket by Chris Heinold. Definitely a foul by Warren Bradley. That is the first basket they scored since 10 minutes of the first half, since the 10-minute mark.
Boy, they've got to be parched at this point. That's a long drought.
Well, Heinold just put 3 points on the board for them.
And Chris Heinold bats the ball away, a long pass from Eddie Bryant. 39-24, Vikings by 15 and in control here. Mouse McFadden thought about the three. And then thought again, considering he was standing in front of Kevin Mackey.
They were 2 for 3 in the first half. Kenny Robertson marred what might have been a perfect performance. He missed his attempt. So the Vikings were 2 out of 3.
Long skip pass to Vianchek, takes baseline, shoots the running one-hander, and he is fouled in the process by Jeff Taggart. Taggart's first personal foul. And Vianchek really has had a tough time getting untracked here this evening. He picked up 3 personal fouls before the doors closed here at Woodling Gymnasium.
What did you call that, a skip pass? That looked more like one of those bombs that Pat Ryan was throwing today against the Kansas City Chiefs.
Yeah, unfortunately, the Jets got stoked up a little bit. Now they'll come to the lakefront next Saturday afternoon, the Browns and the Jets. What do you think?
I like our chances.
Yeah, I'm still not convinced that the Jets have the defense to stop Cleveland.
Vianchek gets in the scorebook now for the first time today.
17-point bulge. Cleveland State in command at this point. But there's a long way to go. 17 and a half minutes left. Fans used to seeing their Vikings score 100 points at home. Don't think that'll be the case here this evening.
Well, they had 99 versus Maryland Eastern Shore, and there's a steal by McFadden.
Mouse at the line in traffic, has it stripped, no foul, and they'll come back the other way. Davis inside, shot nearly blocked, but a beautiful, beautiful flip shot by Davis. Or make that Brian Smith, I should say.
Right
over the top of Warren Bradley.
I don't know if you were giving me credit for that basket or not.
I know one thing, that was a prayer, but it went in. Bradley high off the floor, couldn't come up with a block.
Clinton Ramsey now with 6 points this half, 13 for the game.
Clinton scored 16 against Canisius in the first go-around earlier this year.
I overheard Coach Nick Makarchek say when Ramsey took that shot, that's where we don't match, so evidently there's a defensive breakdown.
And they're playing some matchup zone. Somebody better find the seam, because if you let Ramsey stand there and shoot all night long, you're in big trouble.
Good effort by Pat Vianchek, but just couldn't quite come up with the basketball.
might mention the fact that Clinton Ramsey, I think, has now made six shots in a row. Boy, is he on a streak at this moment.
Including a three-pointer.
Now, you won't see many of those three-pointers if you're a Cleveland State fan. But there's no need to. What the heck? If you can get a layup for some pressure defense to turn some offense, you don't have to shoot from out there.
I think that Tanish is going to have to start taking a few of those if it gets any further into the game and they're still down by as many points as they are.
Jeff Taggart with his first 2 points of the night hit a bank shot off the left side. 15-point advantage, 43-28. Ramsey right wing. And Jeff Taggart cannot believe it. He looks at Murph Shapiro and says, Murph, all I did was hand check him and I got whistled for the foul. And we've got an officials timeout. So with 15:39 left in this one, the Vikings lead by 15. And you're watching Cleveland State Basketball on 19. Welcome back. Denny Schreiner along with Alan Davis, and our score with 15:39 left is Cleveland State 43 and Canisius 28. And there you see it. If you have a question for Coach Kevin Mackey, right to Behind the Bench, 2720 Van Aken Boulevard, Cleveland, Ohio, 44120.
Please write soon. I'm running out of questions to ask the coach. I can't make them up anymore.
You mean Santa didn't give you a couple? McFadden's jumper won't go. Rebound foul inside. And Warren Bradley, I think, is the guilty party.
Well, he called that on Clinton Ramsey. That's his first. Boy, I'd like to see that one again, because at least from this angle, we saw Clinton, or rather Warren Bradley, commit a personal, but maybe, there we go. Okay, he reached in, and that's where he got caught, with his hand in the cookie jar.
There's a steal for Sean Hood. It's a race to the backboard. Inside reverse layup. And that's what Sean Hood does best. Steal it and take it the length of the floor.
Great move by Sean, and he almost drew a personal with it.
Sean Hood now with four on the night, and it's 45-28.
And Sean Hood only scored five in the first meeting between these two clubs.
Marvin Bailey, who was a force in the first half, hasn't done much in the second half. Another turnover. The mouse takes it inside. Shot is blocked. Whistle and called. Goaltending on Michael Ray Jackson or Marvin Bailey. I don't know. I thought it was Jackson myself.
Well, let's take a look at it and see. Yeah, it was Jackson. Bailey's, well, I don't know.
No, it wasn't. Bailey came in late and blocked it.
As we see Marvin getting set to leap there. Well, he comes and makes up for it on the other end here with his basket.
And in a big way, Bailey now with a dozen, two-hand slam. Elgin Womack seeing his first playing time in half number two. Big senior center, had 1 point in the first half. Mouse McFadden thought that Salters was going to go baseline and bounce past it right out of bounds. And Kenny McFadden will sit down, and Kenny Robertson, number 21, out of Barberton, Ohio, will check in.
You know, seeing that slam by Bailey reminds me that Ray Salters told me before the game, that's one thing he wants to do with tonight's game. He wants to dunk one.
Terrific play that time by Michael Ray Jackson, who penetrated, passed off, and Heinl just simply couldn't find the handle on the fast break, and Cleveland State will bring it back the other way. Vikings by 17.
There you saw the contrasting view of the two coaches. Great feed by Robertson.
Ray Salders, the recipient of a beautiful assist. Salders now with eight. And this one has turned into a run and stun affair. The Golden Griffins about ready to head back into hibernation.
Wonder where you picked up that phrase, run and stun. Have you ever heard that before?
Sure, I watched the videotape that Coach Kevin Mackey put out. Tough play inside,
yes.
And Bailey gets called for traveling. What an athletic move to pull down the lob pass, but he couldn't plant his feet in time.
Well, he had three white shirts around him, and I'm sure that made him think twice about it.
That's one thing. If you do post up low on Cleveland State, you're going to find some traffic in a hurry. Boy, terrific play just to get to the basketball.
Percy Strong had a finger on that, too.
Half-court trap now being employed by Canisius.
Vikings are making some interesting passes tonight. A lot of lobs.
Traveling?
Either that or he touched the baseline.
One of the two, but I have a feeling that he did step across the baseline.
Well, that's Percy's bread and butter move, that baseline drive, as you see Ray Salders take a steal here.
Salders in the secondary, took the pass. Oh my, what a wild scramble down low. Shot! Amongst the tall trees, how in the world did he ever get that shot off?
And he releases it from so low, such a low point, that you wonder why it doesn't get blocked more often than it does.
Well, he cleared out a little room inside and shot that one from the hip. Sean now with six. Oh, what a tough shot inside. 51-30. Vikings in total control now. Whistling a foul down low. Hersey Strong caught bumping Marvin Bailey that time. And three fresh reserves check in. Pat Vianchek, Warren Bradley, and Eddie Bryant.
And you know, Sean Hood, who's going to the bench right now, has become probably our most effective post-up player at 5'7", the smallest guy on the team.
Hey, you know, Spud Webb is no small potato.
That's true.
He'll take you in there post-up and dunk on you.
Great steal there by Warren. Good heads-up play, but unfortunately they can't convert.
Eddie Bryant with the Daryl LaMonica special there that Vianchek couldn't find the handle on. This has turned into a helter-skelter affair, which is exactly what the Vikings love. They feast on this kind of a basketball game.
And right now with a 21-point lead.
Warren Bradley with a near save right in front of the Canisius bench. But not quite in time. Nick Makarchuk trying to get that basketball down low, if at all possible, but the Vikings doing a beautiful job of collapsing inside.
The Golden Griffins have not played well on the road this season. First two road losses, they lost by a total margin of 57 points.
Those losses coming at the hands of Syracuse and also Cornell.
No two lollipops. They're down 21 right now. I think that loss to Cornell was about 22 points.
I think it was 28, and Syracuse beat them by 20. Boy, power move inside by big Mike Brown. That's Brown's first hoop of the evening.
And this is the guy that they're looking to give him that help in the middle. And so far this season, he's only averaging 2 points a game.
Vianchek tried to dish off to Kenny Robertson, who had the ball slapped out of his hands, and they're going to rule that Canisius will get the basketball as Clinton Ramsey and the Mouse McFadden check in. We've got an official's time on the floor, though, with 11 minutes and 37 seconds remaining here in the basketball game. Cleveland State on top by a bundle. They lead Canisius 51-32, and you're watching Cleveland State basketball action on 19. Da-da-da-da-dum. Dee-dee-dee-dee. Oh. Okay, Jim, we have the rich man, poor man promo. Huh? Wait a minute. I think I'm going to do this one again first, the CSU Florida A&M. Let's CSU.
Tickets will be on sale after the Cleveland State home games.
The Rattlers.
Hey, Jim, might have to save that, Jimmy, because we're coming back to play here. Okay. We're back at Woodland Gymnasium. Denny Schreiner along with Alan Davis. Vikings comfortably ahead at 51-32 with 11:20 left in this one.
Well, still plenty of time, although this team has not played well on the road, as we alluded to, and they don't look like they're a good comeback team, especially when they're this far behind. They really haven't taken that many shots. We showed the statistics at halftime. Cleveland State outshot them 2-1.
Kenny McFadden with some Harlem Globetrotter-like moves. Kept the ball alive, took it down the floor, got it to Ramsey, who was fouled in the process of shooting by Michael Ray Jackson, and Ramsey will shoot a pair.
And that's three on Michael Ray, as you see the showmanship of Kenny McFadden, the pass to Clinton Ramsey, and there was nothing that Michael Ray Jackson could do but foul him.
What a marvelous ball handler. Really is a magician with the basketball and prides himself in those creative moves. Clinton Ramsey with 14 on the evening. And make it 15 as the senior forward shows that soft shooting touch.
He's 2 for 2 from the free throw line tonight, and by the way, 14 more free throw attempts, and he will break the career record for most attempts in a college career at Cleveland State.
Ramsey with a helter-skelter shot. Fallaway jumper got fouled by Michael Ray Jackson again. And so ditto that foul of just about 20 seconds ago. Michael Ray with 4 personal fouls. One more, and he'll be back on the bus. Ramsey could make a living at the free shot line, too.
Saw him here 2 years ago, was a perfect 16 of 16 from the free throw line against Akron University. It's 3 of 3 tonight.
And speaking of 16, that's how many points this senior forward has. Oh.
We jinxed him.
It never fails. That's it. That's the last time this year on 19 that you and I are going to talk about what great free throw shooters people are. All right, remind me about that the next time we get into
it. Well, why doesn't it work in reverse when we talk about how bad they shoot free throws? They never come up with a good performance, but they come up with some great steals like that one.
Mouse McFadden to the basket. Oh, he blew the bunny down low. It was a tough try on the reverse layup, but I know he's upset with himself. Now it's a 2-on-1 break the other way. Bounce pass, Heinold takes it in. Reverse layup, no good. He'll put it back up off the glass and finally score down low. Well, persistence pays off.
And Warren Bradley got away with one there because he was all over Heinold, and evidently neither one of the officials saw it.
Warren Bradley with a turnaround spin move that didn't hit anything but Taggart's hands on the way back down.
I'll tell you one thing, when Warren Bradley learns to make that shot, he is going to be a force to be reckoned with.
Clinton Ramsey called for a bit of a reach foul. Obviously a sign of fatigue. When you don't move those feet defensively, normally it's because you're tired.
Well, that's why Kevin Mackey plays 10 men.
Yes. Feet kind of forgot to move.
He moved into him.
Yeah, he did. Percy Strong back in the lineup. Pat Vianchik sits down, grabs a towel and a cool glass of water. Now
okay.
A whistle and a foul down low.
He didn't get away with that one that time. But Warren Bradley has been playing great defense against Heinold, who is a little, actually, they match up pretty evenly.
54-34, Vikings by 20, under 10 minutes to play. Baseline jumper no good. Warren Bradley skied for that rebound.
That's what he does best. He's aggressive on the boards. And Hersey Strong loses the pass.
Another beautiful full court pass by number 5, Eddie Bryant. And Hersey couldn't hang on to that one. Bryant's been going deep. Hasn't come up with any two-pointers yet, though. Long pass, and now there's a steal. The mouse is on the move, and he'll take it up and just softly lay it on the glass. And now the mouse has 19, and he leads all point getters.
Notice how this time he slowed down, and he made sure that he had the ball. Good slap steal by Eddie Bryant.
Ramsey to the mouse. Shot is blocked. Goaltending is called on Chris Heinold. And now the mouse has 21, and Canisius wants a timeout. And you can't really blame him. The running stun crew is really taking over here as they lead by 24.
Okay, here's the pass to Kenny McFadden. And definitely that ball was up above the rim, and Heinold showing good leaping ability. He has a 29-inch vertical leap. But this time he touched it, and there was really nothing he could do about it. That ball was going in.
Great pass that time by Ramsey. Did you check him out that time, Alan Davis?
Sure.
Did not look at the player he was going to give the ball to, and just until the last instant. And that's how you fool those defensive people.
And you draw the defensive man over to you.
And don't forget, a television event returns to 19 in January, beginning Monday, January 19th at 8 p.m. for five consecutive nights. 19 will present Irwin Shaw's Rich Man, Poor Man. Peter Strauss and Nick Nolte star in the drama that started the mini-series concept, Rich Man, Poor Man, beginning January 19th on 19. And I'll be the rich man, and you can be the poor man, Alan.
Well, I'll tell you right now, I think that Nick McCarchick is playing the role of poor man in this drama that we are seeing unfold before our eyes. There's not really much drama to do, you know, not much drama to it.
How about a miniseries? You and I will write it on Cleveland State basketball. What do you think?
Oh, definitely.
I'm sure Kevin Mackey would love to star in that. And the mouse McFadden, of course, loves the lights.
We'll call it Viking or Day of the Viking.
Good. Right, well, now it's the Night of the Vikings. And there's
right.
Another steal. Ramsey with a basketball. Inside, running one-hander, switch. Ramsey with 18, and boy, has he been a factor in this one tonight. Another pass, another basket, Ramsey with 20. They're making it look easy right now, and Canisius is a pretty doggone good basketball team, but they've been embarrassed here this evening.
Well, they haven't played well on the road. It's a little different than when you're at home.
Another steal, another basket, another foul, and another free throw for Ken McFadden. McFadden now with 23. McFadden and Ramsey have simply taken over the basketball game.
And here it is. And a great, great shot, and he's going to go for the three.
Kenny McFadden shooting just a fraction better than 50% from the field on the season. And through nine games, he's at 73.8 from the free throw line. Trying to convert and make it a three-point play, and he doesn't. Oh, in and out. 64-34, and Cleveland State has blitzed Canisius here in the second half. It was a 12-point basketball game at the intermission. Oh, my. Power move to the basket by Grady Minnick, who got the stuff and also picked up the personal foul, personal call on number 25, I believe. That's Greg Lockhart.
Well, let's take a look and see. I believe it was Hersey Strong. It was pretty obvious that time.
You're right. Well, there's the plant, the jump, and the jam.
And Grady Minnick now with 4 points. Minnick has five. He's 3 for 4 from the line. And we mentioned he didn't play in the first game against Cleveland State, recovering from a broken ankle. He's had a share of bad luck.
Oh, was that a dandy of a move down low by Hersey Strong, who has been pretty quiet here this evening. That's his first 2 points of the night. Great spin move inside to use the left hand. Bailey with a pull-up jumper now has 14 on the night, and it's 66-39. This one, for all intents and purposes, is in the hands of Cleveland State.
But you know, now Canisius is trying to come back. They're getting a little more aggressive on defense, and they're also taking more shots, and they should have done that a long time ago. I'm surprised that they haven't done that before now. Now it might be a little bit too little too late.
Jump ball is the call down low. Rule of possession will keep the basketball at this end of the floor. Canisius will have it. We've got a timeout on the floor. And so with 7 minutes and 30 seconds left in this one, Cleveland State is off and running. The Run and Stun crew in full gear right now. And you're watching Cleveland State basketball on 19. Boy, that's a bunch of steals, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Man, oh man. I wonder what the record is for...
In a game?
Yeah. What did he have on the season coming in? He had, he led the team coming in with 26.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Knights of 7-0 at Woodling Gym is a sellout at 3,048. Cleveland State Athletic.
I'm going to announce that. Okay. Hey, do you want to try and pop that January 12th game? I don't know. It doesn't look good, Jimbo. We'll get it in some other time. Canisius with a basketball, and the jumper inside is good by Jamel Mosley. That's his first 2 points of the night, and Ray Saunders beats everybody down the floor, gets a beautiful pass, and Saunders now on the night with 10. Boy, it's tough. You work real hard to get a basket, somebody throws it the length of the floor, and the other team gets a layup. That's demoralizing.
Well, at least more people are scoring now. You see more of them going to the basket.
Near steal that time by the talented Brian Smith. Thus far this evening, with 6:57 left, Allen Davis, Cleveland State has forced Canisius into 35 turnovers. Mouse McFadden with 8 steals thus far this evening. The Mouse leads the ball club in that department now with 34 on the season, and he's been turning them into two-pointers as well.
And he had 4 steals against Canisius up there in Buffalo the first time these two teams met. So evidently he likes to feast on Canisius passing.
Percy Strong with a very, very quick move to the baseline. And Grady Minnick gets whistled for the personal foul. Percy, probably the best in the business in northeastern Ohio at head and shoulder faking and taking the ball to the basket via the baseline.
Well, I'll go one better, and that's a fellow that played here last year, now playing with the Golden State Warriors, Clinton Smith. And evidently, Percy, during his redshirt year last year, sat and watched Clinton Smith do that very well so often. He had the most explosive first step on anybody that I ever saw.
I'm sure George Karl saw it more than once as well, and he was the gentleman who drafted Clinton Smith, and he was playing some for Golden State.
That's right.
Nice give and go inside, and the bucket is good by Minnick, who hammered Hersey Strong in the process. 68-45. Cleveland State with 6:12 remaining here. Vikings in a position to win their 5th straight. Ray Saunders in the stack extended himself and got, what, 2 or 3 more yards? Did he come close to the first down? My, my, my. He is a strong player, too. I mean, you try and stop him and you've got some serious problems.
Boy, he really had a crowd in there that he had to work through.
Geez, he's only triple teamed here. I wonder why he didn't get the shot off.
Look at it better from this angle. Look at that. 3 guys around him. He's still going to go up at it. Minnick had a hand on the ball, but he also had a hand on the arm.
Free shot, no good. Oh, my, what a mad scramble that was.
First and 10.
Yeah, pass was incomplete. Man, oh, man. Players are flying all over the place, but that's Cleveland State basketball, believe me. Vikings not afraid to go to the floor. Beautiful save that time by Chris Heinold, who ricocheted off the ankle of Greg Lockhart.
Very alert play by Heinold. Almost stolen. Ho, ho!
Well, that one was worth the price of admission. The jam by Bailey, that's his second high percentage jam of the evening. Heinold at 6'8 with a dandy of a pass down low.
Unfortunately for Canisius, though, it only cuts the lead down to 21 points.
And with 5:20 left, the clock is beginning to become an enemy of Canisius. When you play on the road, that clock just seems to lag and lag. Ray Salters, spin move, that's his favorite move. That's his forte, spin move and bank it off the glass. And now Big Ray has a dozen on the evening.
Rambro. You know, he has his own cheering section. When he came out to warm up before the game, he had some kids up in the stands yelling, Rambro, Rambro.
Yeah, and he comes up with a rebound. It's 2-on-1. Robertson bounce pass back to Sean Hood with a basket.
Eight points for Sean Hood, six of them this half.
Brian Smith with a basket down low. Lockhart gets whistled for the foul, and Greg Lockhart can't believe it. But Brian Smith now has seven. He'll head to the line and look for his eighth point of the night.
Nice pass by Heinold. I would think Heinold has to lead the club in assists, at least tonight. Good all-around player. Leads them in scoring, leads them in rebounding. No wonder he was second team all ECAC North Atlantic last year.
72-50. Biggest lead of the night was 30 points.
And playing Heinold is somewhat slightly out of position tonight. He's been playing forward, now he's starting at center.
Warren Bradley committed just a little bit early that time. Warren gets up off the floor just a touch disgruntled, but nevertheless gets called for a personal foul. Warren, a very aggressive player. He doesn't leave any of it in the locker room.
But he's having a very frustrating night tonight. He's only got 2 points and a couple shots that he felt should have gone in, didn't go in, and that tends to add to the frustration level.
And watch that left arm. Yep, inside. Well, I'll tell you what, he might have gotten fouled from behind.
I'll take another look at it and let the fans judge for themselves. No, you might be right on that one.
I'm glad I'm not an official, that's all I can say.
They do have a tough job.
Taggart has it tipped away, and the Vikings are on the move. Vianchek, oh, he converts it, oh my! What a beautiful pass by Eddie Bryant. And Vianchek with four, that was as pretty as a picture.
And did you notice who started it all? Kenny Robertson was the one that tipped it away on the defensive end.
Say, he could be jailed for grand theft larceny, I'll tell you, he's amazing.
Well,
power move inside, Vianchek clears it and then airs it out.
It sounds like a cliche, but he makes things happen, and look at that, he almost made something happen there.
Kenny Robertson and Eddie Bryant were trying to hook up on the hook and ladder, the old alley-oop and jam, and Kenny got sort of boxed out inside, but he came up with the basketball, and then the got fouled. You know what the other guys call him on the team, don't you? His nickname. Call him Superman.
That's right.
If you would have seen the play he came up with the other night against Maryland Eastern Shore, it was unbelievable. He blocked a shot at the defensive end of the floor, knocked it off the backboard, fell down, the ball ricocheted out near half court. He got up, ran, picked the ball up, beat everybody down the floor, and then jammed it, and the place went crazy.
Unfortunately, he is less than super from the free throw line. Came into the game shooting 28%. And he just went 0 for 1.
Well, nobody's perfect.
Right now is scoreless in the game, but he definitely makes his presence felt on the floor.
Nice move inside by Jamel Mosley. Mosley now with four, and it's 74-52. Everybody is sticking around here. Sellout crowd this evening at Woodling Gymnasium. 3,048 on hand tonight. Vianchek down low with a basket, and he is fouled by Marvin Bailey from behind. Pat Vianchek, a 6'5", 205-pound senior. Shooting 51% from the floor on the season, about 65 from the free throw line. He's a better free throw shooter than that.
Making his fifth start tonight.
Pat now with seven on the evening, and we have an officials timeout here at Woodling Gymnasium with 3:15 left here on the campus of Cleveland State University. The Vikings are ahead and in control, and you are watching Cleveland State basketball on 19. Yeah, let's do it now, no matter what. What? You want to get this? Well, let's do that now then. You want to do that now? Oh, good. Player of the game. I don't know. I like Mouse McFadden. What do you think? We'll get that at another break here. Well, I don't know. What do you want to do, Jim? Okay, so let's get that Viking of the game in, huh? Jimmy? Okay, you want to get that Viking of the game in? Okay, we're not going to do that then until...
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to try and get the disclaimer in, Jim. You're watching Cleveland State Basketball on 19. This telecast is presented by the authority of Cleveland State University. It is intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of Cleveland State or WOIO Television is strictly prohibited. Golden Griffins in all sorts of trouble here at Woodling Gymnasium this evening.
And you know, for the benefit of those fans who may be watching us nationally on the Sport Cable Network, you notice one thing, that no matter how big a lead the Cleveland State Vikings have, they never take the press off. Sometimes they've been criticized for it because against lesser teams like Clarion State, they scored 135 points here, and one of the local columnists came out criticizing them because they never took the press off. But that is the way Kevin Mackey plays. 10 men at least are going to see action. 11 have seen action tonight, and they're always going to be pressing. That's why you play so many guys.
Marvin Bailey with 18, and he is the top point producer for the Golden Griffins of Canisius here this evening.
And only came into the game averaging 6.2.
Ramsey inside with a tough shot. Rebound kicked out to Chris Heinold. Number 50 takes it inside, running one-hander, no good, and Vianchik. If Pat is the guilty party, I unofficially have him for five on the night, but let's wait.
Well, you're right. Well, I thought that Eddie Bryant had gotten him first of all, but there it is, and definitely a slap on the wrist by Pat Vianchik, who fouls out with 7 points on the night, all seven coming in the second half.
Pat will never be cheated when he comes out to play. He gives you 115% each and every basketball game. Boy, it's about time for us to start thinking about that Miller Viking of the Game Award. I don't know, Mouse McFadden started so quickly, and he really got the Vikings off and running with 13 first-half points. He has 23 on the night. But, boy, a case could be made for Clint Ramsey as well, who has 20.
I would be leaning toward Mouse McFadden, though, because of the 8 steals. He has certainly created a lot of offense. He hasn't scored the points, but he's always given them off to somebody else.
Now we'll leave everybody in suspense, and we'll wait until after the game to decide. McFadden with a bit of a force that time, though. Now it's 3-on-1. Heinold with a tough pass that Bailey can't hang on to, but the Mouse back quickly on defense slapped it out of bounds.
And that's one of the reasons that I would be leaning towards McFadden.
There's a block by Kenny Robertson. Oh, he closes like a professional defensive back, doesn't he?
The little man is amazing.
Yeah, a pump fake by Mosley that time, who didn't want to shoot it back at Robertson. Kenny Robertson comes down with a basketball. You know, he has the innate ability, when the ball goes up in the air, to go and get it, regardless of who he's jumping against. And that's something you just can't teach, Alan Davis. That's just intuition and the ability to get up there faster than everybody else.
He also has the speed to go along with that leaping ability. And I know that in high school, he did go down to the state as a track man. He ran a 49-second 400 meter. And I know that the track coach here at Cleveland State, Dave Berger, has got to be drooling, wondering, what are you going to do after basketball season's over, son?
I think he has the ability to play two sports. No question about that. Made the first, missed the second. And we're under 2 minutes to go now. Heinold with a bank shot. And the basket is no good. Chris pleading his case. but it's fallen on deaf ears.
If you think he's pleading his case, Nick McCartzik, just standing in front of us, is pleading it even more strongly.
And of course, the next broadcast, as far as Cleveland State basketball on 19 is concerned, will be coming your way on January 12th, 1987 at 8 p.m. And the Vikings will take on the Rattlers of Florida A&M right here at Whittling Gymnasium. Have to bring the snake bite kit.
They have a busy week that week. They also play against Bowling Green that following Thursday, and then open up MQA conference play.
78-57. This one's pretty much out of the wood, as they say. Under 2 minutes to play. Nice move inside. Hersey Strong turnaround. Uh-oh, jam try by Bradley. No good, and he grabbed the rim. Technical foul for grasping as well.
Now, wait a minute.
Murph Shapiro making the call.
Well, I'll tell you, if we have that on replay, I'd like to see that again, because I don't really think that Warren Bradley did anything out of the ordinary. All right, let's take a look at it again. Now watch. I think he was just grabbing the rim to protect himself.
Well, the rule states that if you're doing that, it's not a technical foul. See it one more time. Yep. Tough one to call.
It's a tough one to call.
I think maybe the officials had the correct call there.
I think the best call in a situation like that is no call at all, because the game is out of hand. I don't think that one more point is going to make any difference as far as Canisius is concerned.
Warren Bradley high for the rebound, and he was fouled on the way back down by Marvin Bailey. Well, what do you think? Mouse McFadden tonight? Miller Viking of the game?
Well, we've already given it to Clint Ramsey once, so I think that it's only fair that we spread it around a little bit.
Okay. Good idea. Warren Bradley with a free throw that rattles around and then finally drops through. Well, I have a feeling that if you'd have told Kevin Mackey before the season started, especially with what happened to Eric Mudd, that he was going to be 8-2 when he left 1986, he'd have kind of looked at you with that smile and said, geez, I'd love to be in that position.
I couldn't agree with you more.
I think he's tickled to death at this point. And both losses were very close losses. Uh-oh, there's a miscue. And on the way to the basket, it's a hack fest. Hersey Strong and also Miles McFadden.
With about
a half each of Marvin Bailey, regardless of who gets the personal foul, Bailey is going to be hurting in the morning.
A little bit too much exuberance here on the part of Hersey Strong. He went up for the ball, but came on down with the arm over the arm of Marvin Bailey as Warren Bradley takes a seat.
Bailey with an excellent performance this evening as that one rims in and out. Marvin Bailey with 18 points on the night.
You know, you talk about that 8-2 record for Cleveland State, and you go back to that Akron game. You and I saw that one in person, and you think, boy, if only.
Anthony Gay checks in to the Cleveland State lineup and doesn't waste any time in launching a two-pointer off the glass. Gay with his first basket of the night, and it's 82-59.
You know, here's a case of a guy who is very talented, but just is in that unfortunate situation of being at a school with four very good guards who have experience over him. And right now it's very difficult to find Anthony Gay some playing time. And I know it's got to be very frustrating for him, because his duty is going to be very limited this year.
Jamel Mosley with a nice move to the foul line, got the jumper off. The shot went awry, and there's a whistle and a foul down low. Chris Einold, I think, got called for trying to grab himself a little extra position. What are you getting back to that point about Akron when you talked about the fact that we were there?
If they had made one more free throw in regulation, you know, they only shot 52% from the free throw line, 13 of 25. One more or two more free throws in regulation, that game would have never gone into overtime. And their record very easily right now could have been 9-1.
And when you consider the fact that Akron is, what, 8-1, and a team that went to the tournament last year, would have been great to have a victory over them as far as down the road is concerned when that NCAA tournament rolls around.
And that's nothing to take away from the Zips and Bob Huggins, because they have a very good program over there, and It's kind of a shame when the two teams play that a team has to lose.
Yeah, that was a tremendous basketball game.
Probably one of the best collegiate basketball games I have seen personally.
This telecast is presented by the authority of Cleveland State University. It is intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of Cleveland State or WOIO Television is strictly prohibited. That was a replay there of that. Bailey with 21.
Let's also point out the fact that we also have in the lineup Mike Raby, a walk-on from St. Ignatius. He is number 22 for the Cleveland State Vikings. These guys don't get that much playing time, and you always like to recognize them when they do get in. As we wind down the clock to no time remaining, and that is it.
A couple of last-second efforts, both missing the mark. Kevin Mackey congratulating the Canisius staff and their players. And getting back to that one point, I think Kevin is very excited about the fact that his ball club is 8-2.
That's right, 8-2, and they score 82 points tonight to 61 for Canisius. 61, the same amount of points that Canisius scored in the first game. But this time, of course, the Vikings scored more than the 66 they scored the first time.
And Al and I will be back to wrap up victory number 8 on the season for the Cleveland State Vikings. The final score, 82-61, and you're watching the victorious Cleveland State basketball Vikings on 19. Okay, no Vidius. Now, what are we doing here with this? What are we doing with this Viking of Miller Viking of the Ward or game or whatever that is? Okay.
Right.
Now, I need to read this little thing as far as he's concerned, too, you know. Okay, I'll read it. Okay. 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 So just count me down, Jimmy, when you want me to go here.
Okay.
Oh, good. We're going to throw those up. Oh, good. Okay. Cleveland State fans are milling out of Woodling Gym, and once again, Alan Davis, geez, what's that make Kevin now here? 36-2 overall in 4 years with a victory, 82-61 over Canisius, and it's victory number 8 on the season as far as the Vikings are concerned, and one gentleman who played a pivotal role in tonight's victory was Ken McFadden.
That is correct. He is our Miller Viking of the game, and you're going to see his stats in just a moment. 23 points for the Mouse. Had 22 the first time these two teams met. 2 rebounds, 8 steals, and I think that's the key statistic of the evening.
And the Mouse will receive a plaque, and also a donation will be made to the CSU Development Fund in the Mouse's name. And, of course, the good folks at the Miller Brewing Company supplying that. The Viking of the game, Ken McFadden. That was a tough decision, basically, too, because Clinton Ramsey had a heck of a game this evening.
20 points, and he really came on strong in the second half. But as we said earlier, we should spread it around a little bit. Clinton Ramsey did get the Miller Viking of the game the first time we telecast the game.
That's right, and there are still plenty more games to come. And Al and I will be back to wrap things up here from Whittling Gymnasium right after this message. You're watching Cleveland State Basketball on 19. What's next, Jimbo?
Huh?
Hello, Sports Central. What's next here? What am I pitching this thing to? Are we, as I leave tonight, do we have a show coming up here, or what's the deal? Do I not promo any of this stuff? So I just say goodnight then, right? Okay. Well, give me these. Am I going to see a graphic of that? Okay, good. Okay. Happy New Year. And Merry Christmas and Happy Hanukkah.
Oh, my God,
now, Jim, you won't show Alan and I anymore, right?